LoveLine is meant for an adult audience.
LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content.
Listener discretion is advised.
Oh, now here's LoveLine.
With Ricky Rackman, Dr. Drew, and Adam Carolla.
Good evening and welcome to the show that is called LoveLine. Five nights a week, taking your calls regarding love, relationships, sex, and of course, if it itches, burns, scratch, or drips. You can talk to me, Ricky Rackman. You can talk to him, Adam Carolla. And of course, you can always get the proper answer from Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew is a board-certified internist and addiction medicine specialist. Also want to tell you, coming up in about 20 minutes, we have Holly Hallstrom, who is she was one of the girls from The Price is Right. And I don't want to tell her story yet, the deal with Holly.
Okay? All right, we won't say anything.
We'll wait till she tells her
story.
But
I will say she was on for 18 and a half years.
Wow.
It's amazing. Huh. Like John Belushi was on Saturday Night Live when she started, and Carter was in office when she started that job.
And she's 23 years old.
Amazing.
Isn't that wild?
She was a zygote for her first season.
Oh, and I have to just please understand, everybody. I'm still having these back and neck things, and I'm feeling kind of,
you know,
I'm
what,
feeling
I think,
very sluggish today. I feel like crap. Right
I think
now.
Your head weighs too much.
Because I dyed my hair back to black.
Yeah, because does the old stuff come out, or you just kind of go over it?
You put black over the pink.
Okay, but you have to bleach it out?
Back in black. What? Not to dye it black.
Oh, okay. Well, you look good. You look sporty. You may be in pain, but you're real easy on the eyes tonight, Ricky.
All right. Hey, the number is 1-800-LOVE-191. That's 568-3191. Of course, if you want to fax, you can at area code 310-854-4455. You know what? We're going to get to the calls right now, and let's start with Claire calling from Chicago. Claire, welcome to LoveLine.
Hi. I have a question. Okay, here's the story. I'm having a baby, all right? And I didn't want to have an abortion, and so I told my boyfriend that, you know, I was going to have the baby and everything, and he's in the service. And so I didn't really decide if I was going to keep it or give it up for adoption. I just decided I wasn't going to have an abortion. And then I thought that I wanted to give it up for adoption, and he wants to stop me. Can he do that?
You guys, it's your boyfriend. You're not married.
Yeah, and we're really not together anymore either.
Is he overseas?
Not really, but...
So you're asking if he can oppose you putting it up for adoption?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he can.
Wait. Why are you against the idea of giving him the child?
Because he's not going to take care of it. He's just going to give it to his mom to take care of.
And why would him giving it to his mom, where the father can see the child, be worse than giving it up for adoption?
Because he won't see it. He'll be in the Navy. He'll see it twice a year. And
he will know who his real father is, and his mother will take care of it.
And he doesn't even have a job, and she doesn't have a job either.
So
he's kind of screwed up and stuff.
Oh, you're just one of those bitter chicks.
No, wait a minute.
I'm not a bitter chick.
You're a bitter chick.
She's just not in favor
because
of these people as being the
parent. Because I know that it's going to end up that if he decides to take custody of it, that it's going to end up that I'm going to be the one taking care of it anyway.
Is that because you feel you
have to bail him out of stuff?
Bitter
and
chick.
I just don't think either one of us are ready to be parents. And, I mean, I thought I was making an adult decision.
I agree with you, Claire. I think you're making a fine decision. I support it. It's got to be very difficult for you. I imagine, though, it would be equally or perhaps more uncomfortable to know that the child was still within reach. It was just, you know, in your sort of...
Yeah, that's the thing. It's like
equally uncomfortable.
Terribly uncomfortable because she really wants to have a separate family for the child. How can she not be the mother if the child's next door or with her boyfriend's mom or something?
Yeah, his mother lives down the block.
That's a very bizarre.
Yeah, well, what's so bad about that? What's so bad about this lady, about the mother having it, and then once in a while you seeing this kid?
The environment that it would be raised in is not a very healthy one.
So the two things I see are this. One is that it's not her choice of what a good family environment would be for her child. And number two, it's very strange boundaries, right? Think of the child. What's the child going to think? Well, Mom, you had me raised by this guy. I mean, it's very peculiar.
Kids like that are always screwed up.
Exactly. I mean, instead of giving it to a family that, you know, has been waiting for years to have a baby.
Right. Yeah. Well, look, you know better than anyone if this guy's in any shape to do any fathering.
No,
and you're
she
saying,
doesn't. She's
why not
his ex-girlfriend?
Well, she certainly knows
really,
better than we do.
I mean,
they're not even ex.
It's not really like we broke up on bitter terms either. I mean, it's just kind of like, you know, we're not going to get married, you know, like that.
I think you ought to try to keep the legal system, keep as far away from the legal system as you can in this issue, and try to settle it amongst yourself and convince him that it's better for the child. And if you need to assert your rights, whatever they are in Illinois, I don't know. You know, we're not legal experts, certainly not interstate legal experts. So you may have to get a legal opinion.
I bet you buy this guy a new set of tires for his truck and he forgets all about it.
Forgets all about what, the baby?
His kid, yeah. I don't think he'd want to be saddled with the responsibility of taking care of this guy at his age.
Bitter chick. 1-800 Love. I'm warning people, man. I'm not all together here. Here's a fact. Dr.
Why,
Drew.
Why are you out of it?
I feel sluggish.
He's in pain and his head weighs a lot from
sluggish.
The coloring.
I feel sluggish.
You were taking some for your neck or something?
No. Can I? Got anything?
No. Advil.
Please?
Advil.
Huh?
I got something in the van.
I know what you're trying to. Dr. Drew, I masturbate, and after I ejaculate, my dick goes limp. What the hell's wrong with me?
Hmm.
Oh, boy.
Do we all want to have a try at this one?
You're a man.
Yes.
Okay, that would be his problem?
I'd say that would be it, yes.
This is Mike from St. Paul. Mike, welcome to LoveLine.
Hey, fellas.
Hey.
I've got a question for Adam, actually. A friend of mine works at a video shop. It's like a local, I don't know, just like a local shop here in St. Paul, and... I don't know. I know you went to the porn convention this past weekend.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, well, there's a lot of stuff that comes in, like the freaks of nature and all. Like,
sure.
That, you know?
The whole series, right.
Yeah. And
what
I
is that? What is that?
And then there's, like, the Rancharama series and all kinds of weird
that?
Stuff. Drew, you have no inkling of what's going on out
You're
there.
You're right. I have to look to you as the oracle of...
Okay, look. I've never seen the Rancharama series, but if I had, I just would tell you that those parts of it, like with the guys with two dicks, that ain't real, okay? Of course, I've never seen a Rancharama series, and the ones with the girls with the nipples that are 4 feet long, those aren't real, too. Like I said, never seen it, but if I had, I could tell you those ones aren't real.
Definitely, man.
I would agree, but what's your question?
I guess my main question is, how do they deal with that whole, you know, is this like totally prosthetic action there?
Well, here's what I know about the prostheses when it comes to the pornography realm.
Alrighty.
Anytime you see a studded, what amounts to be like a what amounts to be like a truss setup, like a leather harness.
Yeah.
Like when a guy's got a penis that's 8 feet long, but he's wearing a belt.
Oh, yeah. Always.
Believe me, when the belt comes off, the penis comes off too. And when the belt comes off of those boobs that are the size of Winnebagos, the boobs go with them. So anytime you see that studded truss system, you know there's monkey play.
I gotcha, man.
All right.
Well, Holly Hallstrom just walked in, and she's now wondering how quickly she can walk out.
She walked in just in time for the 6 foot penis explanation.
Right now, we're going to go to Nicole from Santa Barbara. Nicole, you are on LoveLine at 1-800-LOVE-191.
Hey guys, how you doing?
Good.
Hi. Hey, I want to say thanks a lot. I won tickets last night for Biloxi Blues.
Oh, great!
Really are you going to go?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, I'm going to go Saturday.
Oh, I'm going on Sunday. They told me that's the only day I can go.
I'll keep the seat warm for you.
My question is for Dr. Drew, actually.
Yeah.
Dr. Drew, I'm having knee surgery next month.
Right.
And it's going to be my second on both of my knees. 7 years ago, I had both of them scoped. Mm-hmm. And afterwards, became really heavily addicted to codeine for about a year. Mm-hmm. And now I can't take codeine at all. It makes me really sick. So I'm really concerned about... Afterwards, this surgery is going to be pretty major, I guess.
Right.
It's not going to be arthroscopic?
No, they're cutting me open and breaking my bone and doing all kinds of...
Because I got to say something real quick. I had arthroscopic knee surgery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And about 2 days after the surgery, with stitches still in my knee, got into the biggest street fight of my life.
No.
Like kung fu frickin' theater in the middle of the street. I mean, I had a few beers in me. But, I mean, I was throwing roundhouse kicks and karate chops, and we're rolling around the street, and there was like five guys involved. The knee performed beautifully.
That's great, Adam. Who's your doctor?
I was going to Kaiser Permanente at the time.
I went to Kaiser Permanente with a broken wrist, and they put an ace bandage on my ankle.
Oh, my God.
Permanente is kind of a stupid name. It's like, yeah, you're checking in, pal, but you ain't going anywhere.
Man.
This is permanent.
Nicole.
Well, anyway.
Nicole, let me ask a couple questions.
Yeah.
Now, you got off the opiates.
Yeah.
And did you do it just by withdrawing from the medication, or did you have to get into a recovery program?
Well, actually, what happened was I was so young. I was 13. I didn't realize I was addicted to them.
I see.
Okay. And I had 3 bottles of the drug in a purse and no refill prescription. My purse got stolen.
Okay, so you just detoxed cold turkey.
So I detoxed cold turkey and actually had a boyfriend, like, make me realize, you know, you're going through withdrawal.
All right, okay.
So I was really sick for 3 days.
Okay. Have you been addicted to anything else ever?
No.
Do you have any tendency to abuse alcohol?
No.
Is there any family history of alcohol?
Yes.
Where's that?
Father, grandfather.
Okay.
And my mother was addicted was addicted to Demerol.
All right. So there's opiate addiction in your family.
Yeah.
Alcohol in your family. So we could suspect that you are at least biologically predisposed.
Right.
It manifested at a young age, and now, lo and behold, here it is again.
Right. And right now I'm on a non-narcotic painkiller, but it's making me really nauseous, even just one.
Which one?
Darvocet.
Darvocet is an opiate. It's a weak opiate. Yeah.
Okay.
Nicole, this is a kind of an awkward situation because you really are just sort of manifesting evidence of a predisposition for addiction in many ways. I mean, you really not had any consequences of your use except that you become biologically dependent and you may have had some minor consequences. But, you know, ideally you should be accepting addiction as a diagnosis and doing something more deliberate in terms of treating it.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what... God,
Drew,
what
about those things I've seen on late night TV? They look like a blackhead remover. It's like the pain gun.
Hey, and who was in the infomercial?
Evil.
Our man.
Frickin' Knievel.
I would buy it just because Evil was on it.
All right.
Hey, if it worked for Evil, I mean, he broke every bone.
Twice.
Guys, but give me a break here.
Nicole, here's what I usually do if people have a history of opiate addiction or in recovery is I tell them to get people from the program involved with them as they're getting off the drugs so they can reflect back to the patient what is pain, what's anticipation of pain, what's anxiety, what's craving, what's a drive to trigger the reward systems. I think what you ought to do is sit down with a doctor ahead of time and talk it out and make a real structured plan for how you're going to use pain medicines, arbitrarily stop them at a certain point unless there's some complication, you know, how many is going to give you, go home with, you know, a certain number supplied per day, and then just be done with it. Be very, very structured with it.
Can I tell you really quickly? I went to a private practice doctor originally for my first opinion and told him about what happened. And originally he said, well, we'll send you home with a morphine machine.
No. Well,
and I said, well, that might not be the best idea. And he goes, oh, okay, well, we'll keep you in the hospital. Well, now I'm going to a doctor who's through an HMO. And he's like, oh, outpatient surgery, you're going home that day.
Yeah, right.
And that just sounds really scary to me.
Well, you're going to go home with oral pain medication. Just don't take 100 pills home with you. Take a couple day supply at a time.
Okay.
And agree that, you know, after whatever his normal period of time, he anticipates their surgical pain to have been resolved, that you will stop taking those medicines at that time.
Okay.
And Darvocet, any these are all opiates, and they all will have the tendency for you to pursue them.
Okay.
Good luck,
Good
Nicole.
Luck.
Thanks so much, you guys.
Interesting situation.
Play.
Yep. Thanks.
Maybe a shot of rum and she could bite on a wooden spoon like they used to do in the old, you know, the old Civil War days when they took some guy's leg off.
Yeah.
Could you imagine that? You're having your leg amputated and they give you a piece of wood to bite on and a shot of Myers.
We're going to bring on Holly Hallstrom in about 3 minutes or so. Bring on a couple minutes. And, of course, she was on the show The Price is Right, and we're going to hear her interesting story. But right now, let's talk to Lisa. Lisa's gone from L.A. Hey, Lisa, you're on LoveLine.
Hey, Ricky. Hey, Drew. Hey, Adam.
Lisa. Hey.
Okay, my comments to Ricky. A couple minutes ago, that girl called about wanting to put her baby up for adoption, and she was worried about the father and stuff.
Right. I said cut off the arm and cover in goat's blood.
Whatever.
I know. Every time somebody says, Ricky, you just said you're going to say something I probably never said or something.
No, but you just kept calling her a bitter chick, and I just can't believe that you're just so crass about it. I was an adopted child, and I think adoption is wonderful. There are other adopted kids.
Okay. This is what I said. She has a child. She's going to have a child. The father of the child wants the child.
But that might not.
Hold on a second.
Be better.
What? Wait.
Lisa, let him talk.
And why is it better to give the baby up for adoption rather than to give the baby to the birth father? I think it's great that she's willing to give the baby up to adoption. I think it's great that there's people that want to adopt children. I think it's awesome. I am not against, hey, you know what? I may adopt a kid one day. You never know.
Adoption's a wonderful thing.
I agree. I agree. And I think that it is also great that the father wants a child. And for her to say, oh, well, he doesn't have that. She's a bitter chick.
No, but not if she said the guy was in the Navy. His mom's going to raise it. That's not necessarily the best situation. For
and how is that worse? How is that? Is that worse than having the child adopted by somebody you don't even know?
What's wrong with that?
Probably.
But the
point of adoption. Somebody you don't even know. Do you know how hard it is to adopt a baby nowadays? Especially because of, like, you know, like the Baby Richard cases and everything else.
Right.
And
I'm Baby Richard.
And here's going to be a family, you know, two parents, a stable marriage, because
they checked these
things out for years. I mean, my parents were on a waiting list for 5 years.
And Lisa.
Before I was adopted.
Lisa.
And you're automatic. I'm sorry. I don't know.
Hey, I know. I have been spending like 4 years trying to adopt a 14-year-old Swedish, and nothing happened. So I know what you're saying.
Who's 18 now. And the whole plan would have worked out perfectly. Lisa, did you go out and look for your biological parents?
No, not at all.
Good. I don't like that.
It's a slap in the face
to the people. I mean, anyone can have a kid. Yeah. Am I right? Yeah. I mean, anybody.
Yeah.
And these people take this infant and they raise it as their own and they give it the love and they nurture it and everything. And then the kid turns 18 and goes on a quest to find its alcoholic mom.
I want
to. Kind of crap is that?
But you'd be interested just to see.
I don't even want to see my real mom.
No,
she lives up the street.
My real parents are the ones who raised me. My real parents are my father taught me how to ride a bicycle.
Right.
The whole nine yards. And, you know, they weren't perfect because no parents are, but they've given me more love and support than anything else. And, I mean, a couple times growing up, I thought about maybe looking, you know, just to find out, like, they were never sure of my nationality. Or, you know, they thought I was Hispanic, but it was never 100%. So a couple times I thought, well, maybe I should just try to find somebody so I know for sure, well, maybe I'm Colombian, maybe I'm Cuban, whatever.
I'll tell you how to figure out whether you're Spanish or not. Say Linda Alvarez.
Linda Alvarez?
Well, you're not Spanish.
Okay.
Well, wait, what's Michael Buffer? What nationality is him? Does that guy pronounce more R's than anybody in the world? You know who Michael Buffer is, Lisa?
No.
He's the guy that does the ready to rumble.
Right. He's the guy, but when he introduces boxers, he goes, and here we have Julio Cesar Chavez.
What
nationality is that guy?
Those guys are on autopilot because when I did the Golden Gloves many years ago, and when I went into the ring, it went Adam Carolla.
Adam Carolla.
If it ain't Jones, Jackson, or Jefferson, it's That's what mode those guys are in.
Thanks a lot for your call, Lisa. We're going to play some commercial in just a minute, and then we're going to bring in Holly Hallstrom. But I just want to read an email that we got. You know, we were talking about this this guy that does the board here. That he does the board here for Loveline, okay? But he says, look, man, I'll do the board here on Loveline. Just don't say my name. I don't want anybody to know I work for this show. And he got an email. Why wouldn't you want your name announced on the air if you have it online with your occupation at Loveline?
Yeah.
So you better change that because people might find out that you work for Loveline. What job is it that you have that you're proud of other than Tom Likas?
Are you pimping?
Other than Tom Likas.
I sweep the studio afterwards.
But Tom Likas gets to say your name on the air, right?
All the time, yeah.
Mike, do you realize...
Ah, Mike!
Well, I can say
we
Mike.
Got Mike.
Mike, do you realize
the board here.
It's like some girl going, yeah, I'll be your girlfriend, but don't tell any of your buddies. You know what I mean?
I can relate to that.
Are you trying to get me to be your girlfriend or something?
You know where I'm going.
We're
going
to play some commercials, and we're going to come back with Holly Hallstrom.
Loveline.
Loveline.
Loveline!
The phone number for Loveline is 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Everything.
I know.
The things we learn about Mr. Adam Carolla during the commercial break.
Oh, I had my time.
You're a tough guy.
Well, I grew up in the valley, you know.
I grew up in the valley, too.
Well, you know how it was. There's some tough guys around
there.
Yeah,
I grew up in Van Nuys, and I got my ass kicked.
Right, so I decided I was going to kick butt, and I'd get my butt kicked.
You probably kicked my ass when I was a kid.
No.
And welcome back to Loveline. Ricky Rackman, Adam Carolla, and Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew is a real doctor joining us right now in the Loveline studio. And she's like, look, right now it's, you know, about 24 after. Could I leave at like 26 after?
I did not.
Block the door, Drew.
Holly Hallstrom is our guest. Now, Holly was on The Price is Right.
The Price is
forever.
Right.
Forever. And this is like kind of a nice little come to L.A. story about how you got on The Price is Right, right?
Yeah, that's a good story.
Yeah. Now, first of all, on The Price is Right, which is the game show, you were one of the. What is the the term are those? Because you were one of the ones like waved your hand by a washing machine. That's what you.
Well,
did,
there's
sort of,
a
right?
lot of highly technical terms. There's spokesperson and hostess, and I basically just called myself a refrigerator fondler.
Refrigerator fondler.
You know, highly technical work.
Did they used to get like really like, look, when you're putting your hand and waving it over the Maytag, make sure that you, you know, did they get really, did you have like a teacher that taught you how to do that kind of stuff?
Basically, Janice Pennington, who'd been there since the beginning, since the first show, and I came on later, she kind of showed me the ropes.
And the host was always?
Bob Barker.
Who was also in trouble about the
Diane Parkinson.
The Diane Parkinson thing. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know if that if she's your friend or anything.
Who?
Diane Parkinson.
Haven't talked to her in years.
Because really? What was that, Adam? They said that she.
Well,
she
said that he harassed her on the job. Basically, said no sex or give me sex or you're getting fired. Right. Was that the story?
He doesn't know.
That was the story.
That was the story. I believe Bob Barker.
And it turned out that he was sort of vindicated.
Yeah, now she does Playboy, and she's like 80 years old, and they're like airbrushing all over the place. But that's a whole other story. So you were working on The Price is Right for a while.
Forever.
Okay, like 18 and a half years.
Almost 19 years, yeah.
And you look relatively young. So you were old when you started this?
I was 12, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You were 12 years old?
No, I was 24.
All right, so you're 27.
So I'm 27.
How old are you?
43.
You are?
Really?
Oh,
my God.
What do you do?
I'm not going to listen. I got to be really honest because anybody that listens to the show knows that I'm not really a big ass kisser, okay? But you really, I mean, seriously, guys, how old does she look?
She looks like.
If she said I'm 29 or 30, would you believe it?
Oh,
or
yeah,
would you say,
completely.
Easily.
Well, shoot. Why didn't I say 29 or 30?
Wow. So what's your secret?
Vegetarian.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
No big steaks and stuff like that?
No.
But you were
nothing
leather?
Nothing with a face.
Do you wear leather?
Yeah.
You do? All right. Hey.
She says holding up the knee-high boots. No, yeah. Okay.
So you don't go out in the sun or anything like that,
no,
right?
No, don't go out in the sun. I didn't used to wear leather. I only wore non-violent shoes. But
do you ever wear violent leather?
It's all violent, baby.
Yeah.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Now you were doing the show for a while.
A long time.
And tell us what happened then. And I know that there's certain things you can't talk about, as you told me during the break, but we have to find the gist of this.
Well, the gist of it was, you know, being 43 and female, your body, you gain weight and you lose weight.
Tell me about it, sister.
And over the years, I would go up and weight, and, you know, the producers would come and they'd say, lose it, and I would lose it. This time, however, I was on a medication. Actually, it was a steroid, which makes you bulk up and gain weight. So when I started gaining all this weight, the producer came and said, lose the weight. And I said, well, I'm really trying. And I'd hired a trainer and all the, you know, dieting exercise. And I just couldn't lose the weight. And finally, I realized that in order to lose weight, I was going to have to go off the medication, which after Mr. Barker came and told me the second or third time to lose the weight. I did. I went off the medication and started losing the weight, and I thought everything was fine. And then...
What were you on cortisone for? We don't want to ask
you. No, I was on...
prednisone.
No. Keep going. Starts with a P. Progesterone for a hormone imbalance.
What does that mean, Dr. Drew?
Thyroid problem.
No, it's a hormonal thing. Yeah.
It's a chick thing.
It's a chick thing.
Yeah, don't get it. Anytime, let me just say something. Anytime a woman like over 35 says, I had to go to the hospital for like the day or I'm taking some medication, don't go what for?
Okay.
Because it's always something down there you don't want to hear. Well, you know what I'm saying.
Okay. Let's go back onto the story, though. Thanks for warning me, though.
Okay. Too late.
So anyway, the man who owns the show, Jonathan Goodson, called my doctor and asked if I would always have to be on medication, and my doctor explained yes, but that I was on a different medication now and I was losing weight and it wasn't, you know, going to be a problem. And the next day, Mr. Barker came to me and said, obviously this weight problem is always going to be a problem for you, therefore we'd like you to take early retirement. And that was it.
And
I said, no, I don't want to take early my retirement.
Because you've done this show for 18 and some
forever,
years.
And I have a 30-year mortgage, and I'm driving an 8-year-old car, and I'm really not in a position to retire. And it was
and it's the greatest gig ever,
greatest
right?
Greatest gig ever. 3 days a week.
You're standing by some Z-brick. You're putting your hand out to a Maytag washer dryer set, and that's a day, right?
The hardest part of the day was getting up in the morning. After that, it was pretty much a walk in the park.
So they fought. Now, when you had started the show, may I ask around how much you weighed? Or I mean, because looking at you, you're very attractive. You're beautiful. I would never have guessed 43. Okay. Ever.
And you don't look husky at all.
No.
No, I've since lost the weight.
Okay.
I was about almost at my goal weight when they came and said, "Nope, oh, you got to go."
Now, there was a lawsuit, or you sued?
No, I went and started reading some things about myself in the tabloids that weren't true.
Like,
oh, Holly was difficult and confrontational, and we're happy she's gone, and she retired. She just called and retired. And I said, wait a minute, this is not so. And so I issued a statement saying this is what actually happened. I was forced to leave the show because I gained weight on a prescription medication, and all hell broke loose. And Bob Barker slapped me with a lawsuit.
Oh, he slapped you with a lawsuit. Oh, see, I got the whole story.
For not
wrong.
Having sex with him or something?
Hey, watch out. If he's that easy with lawsuits, Adam, you'll be next.
Yeah. So in response to his lawsuit, I had to countersue.
Okay, because what I had thought had happened was, and correct me if I'm wrong, that you had sued them due to the fact that you were fired from the show because you had gained weight.
No, No, I hadn't taken any action towards filing a suit against them or a claim or anything.
Is that all still ongoing?
Mm-hmm.
That's all?
Yes.
Ugh.
Yeah. You know what, though? It's good. It's all going to come out in court. We'll all be revealed. That and a whole lot more, so stay tuned.
Tell us more. Is there any
wow.
more?
That's the stuff I can't talk about.
So, but Bob really? Came up to you personally and said, Holly, you're porking up.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what happened? I mean, he came
not
up,
in those
right
words, but that was the kind of the gist. Yeah,
really?
He came and said, okay. you have to lose weight. And
well,
I agreed.
Let me ask, okay, because that was the question I was going to ask you. Obviously, I was a little bit confused on this whole thing. Do you think that it's wrong if you were fired because you gained weight, would you say that would have been wrong for him to fire you for that?
It would depend on the circumstances, you know.
I mean, how much weight did you gain?
14 pounds.
14 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
So you could see that there was definitely a difference. I mean, I think that most of the people that viewed The Price is Right mm-hmm. really wouldn't say, wow, Holly looks a little bit bigger. I don't want to watch the show. But can you understand?
You know what else? Progesterone weight gain is not fat. It's muscle and it's fluid.
That's what was happening with all this weight and with all the working out. I was getting off.
When you said bloated up, I thought you were talking about cortisones, but progesterones don't do that.
Well, then add in Premarin.
Holly,
and you start, you know. Start.
Do you have any more of that stuff? Because I'm looking to put on a little.
Yeah. But oh no, that's
seriously
not fun. Stuff.
You know, here's the deal. As far as I can tell, there's two other models. There's three of you.
There right? was four of us.
Four of you. Okay. Mm-hmm. Here's my point. And the other three were sort of pretty skinny,
is
pretty
that the
trim
show
girls,
Carol Merrill?
Right?
Oh, Carol Merrill
well,
was on.
Everyone
kind
of went up and down.
All right, I'm betting that one quarter of American men would like to see a woman with, you know, little ass on her. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I know
little is the
little,
word. Adam.
No, I mean
little.
A lot.
They'd
I mean,
like to see a girl with a little
no,
ass.
No, there's guys out there who like a woman with some curves.
What's there's girl, guys out there that read this magazine called Dimensions for women that weigh 350 pounds.
That's mm-hmm. right.
Yeah, but I'm saying when most guys watch a television show like a game show, and this is what I'm trying to say, okay? And I don't mean to take offense to this because I have both ways to see this. When there's a spokesperson like yourself or a hostess or whatever it is, there is a certain look that they want. They wanted an attractive, mm-hmm. usually slender woman to be that type of person. If that woman balloons up, that I can understand her getting mm-hmm. fired from it. Of course, if the person's been on the show for 18 and a half years, I would think there'd be some sort of loyalty. I also believe that most of the people that are watching that show are probably women. And would also feel that, hey, these girls are human. And
well,
would also
the average American woman wears a size 12. I didn't know that. I've learned that.
That's big. Isn't that big, woman?
Hey, 12 is big, isn't it? It's like 2 6.
You know, it depends. I'm almost 6 feet tall, so a 12 is not abnormal for me because of the length. But, you know, everyone is different. But the point you're making, I understand the point you're making, which is, you know, you're hired to look a certain way. The mistake was on my part when I thought that after 18 and a half years, when I said, hey, I'm having a problem here, can you help me? I thought that there would be some
maybe
kind
they
of,
would give you some time off.
Well,
and
you know what, Ricky? We were getting ready to go into our summer hiatus. We had 6 weeks vacation, and I was already losing weight. I was getting near my goal weight. And I said, you know, Bob, can we talk about this when we come back? Because by the end of vacation, I'll be at my normal weight, and it won't be a problem anymore.
Well, Holly, let me ask you a quick question. What do you think Bob's motives were? I mean, did he want some other girl he could bring on? I mean, what was he getting at? If you had 6 weeks off, if you were losing the weight, you're almost to your goal weight, you guys got along fine, you weren't a problem, what was he getting at?
Well, you know, it's interesting, Adam, because at the same time I was asking Mr. Barker for the six-week summer vacation to finish losing the weight, and he was saying no. He was allowing Gina Lee Nolan, whom I love dearly, who is 23,
uh-huh.
7 weeks
yes.
off from taping
okay.
to go do another show.
Well,
and
another,
holding her job
another
open
piece
for her.
To the Bob Barker puzzle comes mm-hmm. in place. I see.
He gets chicks, man.
Okay.
That would be this job to get.
How old is Bob?
Let me see. The first amoeba crawled out onto the land. Bart was born shortly thereafter.
He was swinging a hammer when the first stage was built.
I think he's about 73.
And going and after the young trim, too, isn't he?
He can still get an erection and he's in his 70s?
You know, I would not know about
come
that person.
It takes two bottles now.
We're going to do some commercials, and when we get back, we're going to get to your calls.
LoveLine. Call LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191. That's 1-800-LOVE-191.
LoveLine will be right back.
Sit down, Holly. I shouldn't say that. She could squash me. Holly Hallstrom is our guest on LoveLine. Holly Hallstrom was
one of Bob's beauties.
One of Bob's beauties. But she was hotter than... Did you ever think Diane Parkinson was hot, Adam?
I would have taken any of them when I was 14 and
Diane
sitting
Parkinson.
In front of the TV. And
now, how old is Diane Parkinson? Seriously. They named after a disease after her. She's that old.
Oh, gosh, that's gold. You know, I really don't know. The last thing I read, she was 50.
And you're 43.
43.
I'm telling you, I wish you guys were here. And seriously, you girls, how old? Wouldn't you say she'd like
she looks
late
awesome.
20s?
Seriously.
Did you get any surgery? Did you get any surgery done?
Oh, gosh, you know what?
Did you?
Mother Nature didn't give me.
Face?
I bought with
what
my
about on your face?
Income tax
you
return.
You didn't do anything on your
oh,
face.
Oh, yeah.
Did you?
I've had some liposuction.
You have?
Yeah.
Well, then they did it good.
They did
is
a
it
good
behind
job.
Your hair? Is like their staples
no,
and
no,
stuff?
No, no. This is where they suck the fat
oh,
out.
I should get that.
But it's not like you're going to pull a wig off and there's going to be big staples
no.
in the back of your
the
head like a fembot
Ireland?
Thing.
No.
From
like if you sneeze, your face won't rip or something. Because
no.
you don't look. Because sometimes, like Diane Parkinson, for
no,
instance.
No, see, this is what I need to have done. See, this is what I used to look like.
Don't touch it.
No, you look good. You look good. We got some calls right now. Let's talk to Ryan Kahn from Hermosa Beach. Ryan, you're on LoveLine.
Hey, what's up?
Hey!
Hey, I love your show, but I kind of miss it when it was just in L.A.
I'm sorry, Ryan.
I know. It was hard. But
that's another call.
Yeah, but I want to say hi to everybody.
All
and
right.
I want to say hi to Holly.
Hi, Ryan.
Hi. I, like, watched your show every day when I was sick. Because I was sick, like, a lot when I was younger.
Mentally, or?
No.
Oh, okay,
like,
I see.
With the cold, and I ditched school and watched Price is Right and Young and the Restless and stuff.
It's a fantastic show, isn't it?
Which one?
Price is Right.
Oh, yeah. And Holly was like my favorite person because I like people with red hair.
Oh, do you have red hair, Ryan?
No.
Well, when you get older, you can have the same red color, too. It's red dye number two.
No, I'm still dyeing the blonde right now, but...
Oh.
No, I just kind of wanted to know because I saw like one episode in particular. You were doing this genie thing.
Uh-huh.
Like a fortune teller?
Oh, yes.
Slow
the
down.
Gypsy fortune teller.
Slow down, Ryan.
Yeah, and you know the tarot cards. And Bob Barker was, like, totally gushing on you. And then he came back from break and was, like, gushing
He was
over
gushing
you.
On you?
No, he was like, oh, look like... at her. She did such a good job. She's so beautiful. Da da da.
Yeah.
And, like, now he just, like, kicks you out just like that.
Just like that. It's a tough business, isn't it?
Do you think it would have been, like, let me ask you this, okay, since we're on, thanks for calling, Ryan, since we're on the subject. Let's say you're, I mean, there are certain jobs when I think it is important to look a certain way.
Right. Truck driver.
No. Like, yeah. For instance, if a spokesperson gains weight and you've hired her for that, maybe that would be a good example of, why somebody
is
shouldn't.
Is this the same point you're trying to make again?
What?
You were trying to
and
make
I'm
before
saying,
the break?
And I'm
IndyCar driver.
What?
IndyCar driver.
Well, you can't fit fat people in IndyCar.
Well, there you go. You lose
Ricky,
your job.
I think Ricky, this distills down to his favorite legal argument.
What?
The Hooters problem.
You know what? Exactly. Yeah, now that we're on it.
Yeah. Well, I knew you were going to get to that somehow, so I thought I'd just bring it out.
Well, since if you notice, one of the things is why they try to keep good-looking people on TV is one of the reasons that I decided as I start to get older, it's a really good idea for me to leave TV and get into radio.
I got my Hooters VIP card in the mail today, by the
got
way.
Got one too, brother man.
50% off.
Gotta love that. Sorry.
That's an OJ.
Let's talk to Andy. Andy's gone from Diamond Bar.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hey, Holly.
Yes.
How you doing?
Hi, Andy. How are you?
You know which Andy this is?
No, which Andy is this?
Special effects.
Special effects, Andy?
That's him. That's
you know what? She's making that notion right now, like when somebody's crazy, they do the circle by their head with their finger.
No, I am not. Andy is a genius. Andy, I designed this wastebasket in my kitchen, and I had one carpenter after another, contractor after an engineer, all these people come over and try and make it work. I tried to explain my idea to them. Andy, if you need, out there in America, if you need any help, call a special effects tech. They are on it. They know all the tricks. He made it work in like 5 minutes.
Andy, did he work on
a wastebasket?
Oh, yes.
What's that?
I've got a wastebasket there. It costs 80 cents. I know how to make it work. Andy, Adam, go ahead. Talk shop for a while.
Well, no. I was just going to say, first off, just because you can fix a trash can doesn't make you Copernicus, Andy. I got to tell you.
First off, I think this thing was put in by a guy who rides bicycles for a living.
Yes, Andy.
Ed Begley Jr. put in your trash can?
No, this guy used a brake cable from a bicycle to make this thing work and trip, so.
All right, Liz, Andy, do you work on the show?
Yes, I do.
And you did special effects on The Price is Right?
Well, I do pretty much special effects for the whole CBS building over there.
Oh, really? What do you do?
Oh, he's the special effects master.
What special effects you do on The Price is Right?
Cover up Diane Parkinson's wrinkles.
Oh,
we do that pretty well, don't we? No, we do a lot of physical and practical effects for the show.
Fires.
We do the fires, and you see puffs of smoke.
Explosions.
We levitate, and we build special props. We do all the game maintenance for the show.
Mm-hmm. Gay maintenance.
Game. Oh. G-A-M-E, Ricky.
I was like, there's a lot of stuff on there. I've got to start watching Price is Right more often. Mm-hmm. Bob's boning all these chicks, and they got gay maintenance.
It's like a Kiss concert over there.
Well, and the only I saw Pop of Smoke, I'm like, oh, Bob has gas. I didn't even know any of this stuff that happened on the show.
But you know what? Since Holly left, we don't do half the stuff we used to do. I mean, we used to do all the fun stuff with her.
Morale.
Okay, let me hear about this stuff, Andy. The fun stuff you guys used to do with Holly.
No, I got to keep some of the inside. Or secrets, you know, just that, a secret.
Andy, is morale low now?
You know what? as a general whole, yeah, it is.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
A lot of changes have been made. You know, the companies are going through transition, so there's a lot of downsizing. You know, but
I can't believe that this sounds like we're talking about the government and all this stuff. We're talking about the friggin' Price is Right.
Government is one thing that hasn't downsized.
Yeah,
here we go.
On the whole, yeah, the morale is low. It really is.
And Andy, let's ask you candidly.
Sure.
Was Holly ever like a head case on the set? Was she a pain in the ass or was she good?
Holly was good.
All right.
Holly was really
Diane
good.
Wasn't.
What's that?
Diane's got an attitude.
Yeah, she was real standoffish sometimes.
Yeah. She was boning the boss.
Well, let's talk back about me.
Well,
forget her.
Talk back. We're here talking about Holly.
All right, let's talk about Holly. You dating anyone? You married? What's going on?
I'm married. I got three kids.
Not you, you bonehead. I don't care about Andy and his family and his trash can.
Yeah.
What about you, Holly?
No, I'm not married.
Single.
And I was dating a great guy for 6 years, and we broke up not too long ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. You need someone to pick up.
And you still think he's great?
He's great.
Really?
Oh, wow. How come you guys broke up? Because he got fat.
His trust broke and his gut came out.
Oh, you know, I don't. It's too long a show. Right. We don't have time.
It hurts. So you're rebounding pretty hard now?
Rebounding. No, I'm basically under the cover. It's like.
Right.
Under the covers.
Under the covers with the covers over my head going, oh, my God, I'm alone and unemployed. Oh, great.
You need someone to help you pick up the pieces. Am I right?
Yes, I Adam's do, that Adam. Guy.
I'm like the dustpan of love.
Oh, man, Adam. We're going to talk tomorrow.
I'm the shop vac.
Let's talk to Heath from Boulder, Colorado. Heath.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, Heath.
Hey.
What's going on?
Say hi to Holly Hallstrom.
Hi, Holly Hallstrom. How are you?
Hey, Heath.
Heath, Holly Hallstrom. Holly Hallstrom, Heath. Hi, Heath.
I have a problem.
How's it hanging?
Pretty low, but, you know, Adam, how do you know Copernicus, first of all?
What? I don't know.
You just said the word Copernicus, and you really amazed me.
Isn't that a lot of mythology stuff?
I don't know.
No.
What is Copernicus?
No, he...
That's what it is.
It's what?
He's a mathematician and an astronomer.
Right.
That's like fruity stuff.
You knew that.
Well, thank you, Heath.
Anyway,
See, Holly, there's much more to me than just a good-looking radio host.
Street fighter, yes.
Talk show stud, huh?
Yes.
All right, I have this problem. I've just had this girlfriend for about 2.5 months. It's not really my girlfriend. I met her through a friend of mine. And pretty much all we do is have sex. And I'm having a hard time getting rid of her. I mean, she comes over, she does my dishes, she cleans my house. I mean, she does all this stuff, but I'm really not, you know, I don't want to marry her or anything. And I'm, like, kind of interested in this other girl. And I told her, I don't like you. And then she still comes over.
And cleans your house?
Huh? Yeah, she cleans my house, she does my dishes, she does my laundry, for Christ's sakes. I don't know what to do. I mean, she's awesome. I mean, she'd make a great wife, but she's just not the one for me. I can just tell that.
Have you told her that?
I'm sorry, what?
You have told her that in those words?
Said he didn't like her.
Well, now what did you say to her?
I told her,
you're too good for me.
I said, look, Tanya.
Let's be friends.
You're great. You're just the most awesome, but I'm just not attracted to you in the way that I want to get married to you, and she just didn't understand that.
And proceeded to mop the floor. I keep my mouth shut. I'm a can't help it.
You waited until after she was done with the mini blinds before you said anything, though, didn't you, Heath?
So far, you haven't really.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to get into that.
And Heath, you haven't really said anything about how great she is as a person. You've said so far she's great because she does all this stuff for you.
You can work around the other stuff,
the only
Drew.
Thing that she's great as, I mean, we go out. I try to take her out socially, and she's just inadequate. I mean, she doesn't get
inadequate in what way, Heath?
She's just not like at my level. I mean, I guess.
What's your level, Heath?
Just college education, pretty much.
He's like level three.
Well, what if she went to college? I mean, she
didn't go to college.
She can go.
Heath, that's even better, man. This girl is dumb. She has sex with him, cleans a house. Does she cook?
Yeah, of course.
You are an idiot. You are an idiot, Heath. A dumb girl that cleans and cooks.
Heath, what attracted you to her in the first place?
She's really good looking.
Oh my goodness. You are a moron. Oh, and let me tell you something, Heath. Another big problem.
What?
After we have sex, all she wants to do is go to sleep.
That's right.
Actually, she has to go home most of the time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And she has these friends that work at the Swedish embassy, and they want to join in sex, too, and it's really horrible.
Heath?
Dr. Drew, what do you think?
Let me get a clear bearing on what it is that troubles you. It is that her level of education is not what you think it should be?
We go out, and half the time she doesn't understand what we're doing.
Why don't you encourage
her? If she was any smarter, she'd dump this guy.
She's blowing him while they're driving.
Right.
She doesn't even know where they are.
Encourage
her to better herself through further education.
Why? Why?
Of course, I've tried.
She's not interested.
Colorado here, and she lives in a city that's real close by. And she does.
Here is my just brief opinion on this, and that is, I think if two people are going to have a successful relationship, one of the things they need to have is a similar way of understanding the world and sharing the world.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
And I think people can. Through maintaining a relationship can kind of get to a point where they both have reached a level where they share certain ideas and understandings of things. And that what I'm saying is she could get to that point if you were committed to her. But if you're really not, then you're not. And you shouldn't keep her hanging around. And it's unfortunate for her because she, it sounds, would be benefited from a greater education.
You know what Heath needs? Heath, listen to me. You need Janet Reno to come over for the weekend and talk a little shop with you and straighten out your priorities.
The thing is, I don't think she's ever going to reach this level.
I understand what you're saying, but
I don't even know how to get rid of her.
Heath, 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 Heath.
I mean, I think that this lovely, attractive, obviously generous, caring woman
yeah.
needs about 12 meetings of Codependence Anonymous, and right. then she would dump this guy.
Right.
I think Heath's a homo.
Yeah. Right. I'm with Ricky on this one.
We'll be back.
LoveLine. Call 1-800-LOVE-191.
LoveLine. We'll be right back!
Welcome back to the show that we call LoveLine. Ricky Rackman, Dr. June, Adam Carolla. Joining us tonight on LoveLine is Holly Hallstrom, formerly from The Price is Right. And Dr. Drew wanted to mention something about a fax that was just sent. A
couple of faxes. One was sent repeatedly to us, and a question about male yeast infections. This guy didn't, who knows who this is from. But men can get yeast infections on
Pillsbury Doughboy
on the skin of the penis, and it can be treated very easy with antifungal agents. They also can harbor it in the urethra. This guy says every time his girlfriend comes into town, she gets a yeast infection. And really, anything that changes the environment in the vagina, diet changes, medication, new sexual contacts, condoms even can predispose to a yeast infection. This guy asked, should she see a doctor? Yeah, just to be sure it's in fact a yeast infection. Now all the yeast medicines are available over the counter, pretty much. So you can
for guys
you
too.
Well, you could use Lotrimate. You could use Monistat.
I had one.
I know you did.
I did.
What did you use?
I don't remember. I was like, I had a sack over my head when I was at the pharmacist going, rub, 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 rub. But
it's not a big deal.
Cream. It was like $30. I used it once, and the thing went away. It's like, right. God knows, when you buy the cream, he's going to get rid of it. He just wants to see you being a little responsible. Boom, it's gone. So I'll sell it for $18 if anyone wants it.
Other thing is,
for $20, he'll apply it.
Somebody named Matt sent me a chapter from an article. And this is about marijuana. And I got excited about this. This is the best little synopsis chapter I've ever seen on this topic. So much of the data, so much of the textbook stuff out there in this drug is really pathetic. What I want Matt to do is send me an explanation of where this came from, and I'll answer his question later on the show.
And a urine sample.
The show is LoveLine. Number is 1-800-LOVE-191. That's 568-3191. If you want to fax us, you can at area code 310-854-4455. I'm going to read this real fax before the top of the hour. Dear Dr. Drew, today I used the tampon for the first time. When I was taking out the tampon, I don't even know.
Wait,
read
that
it,
was mine. You weren't supposed to look at it.
Yeah, I can't read those type of faxes. Sorry.
When I was taking out the tampon, the string broke, which means you only have 5 seconds before it blows. Run! When I asked my mom what to do, she went for the salad tongs. No, I'm sorry. She said, you should have been on that faster. She said to wait a couple hours till my muscles relax and then go and get it out. Is this what I should do?
That's reasonable advice. I mean, you can't hurt yourself really by trying to get it out with your hand.
With your man.
It's very difficult to do sometimes, and it's not uncommon for women to have to come into the doctor to get it retrieved.
What about a dust buster?
It's not a big deal. Don't be embarrassed. Happens a lot. But do get it taken care of, because if you just leave it there, it happens a lot.
Ever happened to you, Adam?
Twice.
It can predispose to toxic shock syndrome, so you don't want to just leave it be.
Hey, stay tuned. We got more LoveLine, and we're going to talk to Holly Hallstrom.
This is LoveLine on
Radio Station.
Holly Hallstrom, formerly of The Price is Right, is our guest on LoveLine tonight. Have you ever been married?
Nope.
Really? Do you ever want to get married?
I
find this so... You're such an attractive woman. Well, are you still successful? Or are you not successful? Well, you're like interior decorator lady now, right?
Oh, I've been doing that for years on the side. That's my passion.
So this last guy just didn't work out?
No.
And you think good things of him?
Yeah.
You don't... Does that make it harder, do you think? Like, I've always found out when you get out of a relationship, wish the worst, think the worst.
Oh, we went through that period along. You know, we've broken up several times.
Was this guy a celebrity?
No.
Young guy, though?
No.
Really?
Well, he was my age.
But he must bum out, though, when he sees you, because you still look like you're, like, 29 or something. And
We don't see each other. We don't talk. You can't. If you're going to do it, you just no seeing, no touching,
right.
No feeling.
Holly knows about resetting the clock.
Yes, she's learned that lesson.
We're going to talk to Carl right now from Minneapolis. Carl, say hello to Holly Hallstrom.
Hey, Holly, what's up?
Hi, Carl.
Okay, I got like two questions here. The first one, I was in a bar the other night, and you guys have been talking about condoms lately.
Uh-huh.
In the condom machine, they sold this alcohol neutralizing pill.
What is this? Is to outsmart the law?
Yeah, it says you can fool breathalyzers.
Oh, come on.
I think it's BS, but
BS too. But I can't believe that your state allows that to be sold.
No. Do you know what they also sell in those vending machines, Drew?
Instant.
Oh, it's called Pocket.
Yeah.
What Pocket.
Is it? What is it?
Pussy.
Very nice. Very nice. Thank you for enlightening us. Carl, don't do that. And even more to the point is people should not be drinking face and then taking a neutralizing
agent face
in order to go out and drive their car.
I hear if you eat the pocket pussy, you can get below
0.08. All right. And what's
but it makes your breath smell like fish.
You got hairs in your teeth.
What's your Jesus?
Okay, my other question is for Holly.
Yes.
Sorry, Holly.
Yes.
Holly, after all those years on Price is Right, did you ever get bored of Bob Barker saying, get your pet spayed and neutered and all that good stuff?
You know, actually, I was not there at that time when he was saying that at the end of the show. I was usually back in the green
room.
You
wanted to cut Bob's balls off, I'll bet, at the end of the action.
Let me say this, make this quick observation, Holly. I don't know if people agree or not, but this is my opinion. The people who are really into animals aren't so into people. Like, I think the more you're into kittens, the bigger the a-hole you are. I mean, when you go out...
Oh, shut up.
I don't mean... No, hold on, Ricky.
Look at Bob.
He's telling everyone to be spayed and neuter and do all that. Then
and
he's like, blow me or you're
chicks.
Fired. That's what he says when he gets
bad?
Backstage.
That's bad?
Well, this is for Holly.
I think,
who would you be more
like? You guys,
like?
Wait a minute. Wrong lawsuit.
Right. All right.
I think you mean the people that are just obsessively preoccupied.
Obsessively? Yeah. No, I'm not talking about having 15 or 20 cats around the house like you, Ricky. I'm talking about being obsessive about it. I'm talking about, like, you know, jumping someone because they're wearing some moccasins or something.
Right.
Like Betty White obsessive.
Right.
You obsess about Betty White, Adam?
I've been stalking her for years now. I want some before she goes, you know?
This is Renee from Highland Park.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I think that somebody should tell Bob Barker to take an early retirement.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's up with Bob? Bob's okay, guy.
Beat on Bob night.
Jeez, that's like so, like... like
who's that announcer guy?
Uh-huh.
Jay?
Rod Roddy.
He looks like he's putting on a few pounds also.
Well, you know, isn't it interesting
fat when they
hired him. Rod was born fat.
Well, but that they'll hire fat men.
Right.
They don't hire fat women. Right. Isn't that interesting?
And they don't stick him in a little bikini doing the genie thing either. That's why.
He's not up on the ski boat doing like the simulated, you know, wave. Or the big.
We call it the parade wave.
The parade wave.
It's only from the wrist up. You just move your hand because if you flail your whole arm back and forth, after about a mile, your arm is like paralyzed.
But the boat's not actually moving. You're just sitting there on the set.
No, in the parade.
Oh, all right. In the parade.
Have you done a lot of parades?
No. Oh, I have in the past, but we always call that the parade wave.
Let me ask a quick Price is Right question.
Okay.
Now, you know, the prices. First, they get this stuff.
Okay, time's up.
You got to guess on like a grandfather clock or something that you couldn't possibly ever guess on. I guess that's part of it. But then they get it from some catalog somewhere, right?
Spiegel.
The Spiegel catalog.
Spiegel.
That is the most expensive catalog in the world. Nobody would buy anything from that godforsaken catalog. Am I right?
You'd think if they had, like, the Spiegel catalog, you'd say, hey, and this clock in the Spiegel catalog is only $20. You'd go, wow, that's a... You'd go, whoa, that's a really good deal. I'm going to look at it. But instead, it's like, and in the Spiegel catalog, there's a 12. It's like, who's going to read that friggin' catalog? You got this piece of crap clock for $1,500.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Why don't they take stuff that people would buy and put it at, like, a Circuit City-type price?
I have no idea. I remember when the woman who lived in the apartment won the spa and the airplane. It was like, her face is, what are you going to do with this? And she just faints, like, said, dead away.
Bob Barker sued her too, didn't he? Let's talk to Jeffrey from Denver, Colorado. Jeffrey, you're on LoveLine.
Hey, how's it going, Drew?
Jeffrey?
How's it going?
Good.
Good. All right, I have kind of a lame question. I don't know. All right, I was friends with this guy for, like, 6 months, 7 months, whatever. First of all, I'm gay. And
I thought they don't allow gay people in Denver.
Well, they technically don't, but, you know, we find ourselves...
They just can't vote.
Huh?
We can't vote and can't do a lot of things, but hey, we do it anyway.
Does it actually restrict your freedoms?
No, actually, it's on...
No, that
right
it was a joke, Drew.
No, I understand, but I know they had a lot of problems.
Yeah, there's a hell of a lot of crap in here. Anyway, there's this guy. We've been friends for about 7 months, and found out that he likes me a lot more than was originally the context of our relationship. And
What was actually the context?
Well, he likes me a lot more than just friends.
And can you understand how he might have gotten that idea?
Kind of, not really. I mean, I respect myself. I'm really happy with who I am. I'm not popular in the gay community by any means.
Why is that?
If you ask me, it's because I have a third dimension.
What does that mean?
Fat?
I just feel like the gay community is caught up a lot in how you look and who you date and dating up and so on and so forth.
They also must be getting pissed off because he doesn't have a list. He doesn't talk gay.
I'm curious. What does dating up mean?
Dating up?
Yeah. Kind of like something better.
Dating to gain social status.
Really? Interesting.
Oh, that's what you do?
Well, I mean, okay. Granted, I'm a bitter queen, so. But it was really frustrating for me because, you know, every decision that we made, every activity that we did was, in my mind, as friendship. And it kind of sparked his revelation to me was kind of sparked me to think, well, was he doing that because we're friends or is he doing that for other reasons?
Let me just bring this up. I would think that would make it tougher being gay because when guys and girls are friends, usually the guy is always thinking, hey, maybe there's going to be some sex. And the girl's thinking, well, he's probably thinking there's going to be some sex. But usually guys are, you know, sometimes just buddies. And occasionally, if you're gay, you're buddies, but also you see a guy that you'd want to have as a lover.
Well,
this is back to your theory that
gay men, you are just buddies.
My theory that what, Drew?
Men and women can't be friends.
What?
That's what you're implying there.
Men can be friends with ugly women.
Miss.
Unless they're drunk.
Please, hello. No. Okay. Champion of women's rights, you're talking to them.
Good.
Cruel but
Thank
true.
You.
So it frustrates me a lot. And this is the same thing that happened with one of my best friends. Like 7-8 years ago.
Well, but does this strike you as some kind of an uncommon occurrence in human relations?
Yes, because typically with me, people are very upfront because I'm very upfront with people also.
Did you sleep with this guy?
Oh, no.
Anything?
No.
Well,
I mean, it was all very much, I mean, you know, like I said, I'm very upfront and it was a friendship to me.
So it's not as though he got the wrong idea. He just wants something different out of the relationship.
I guess, yeah.
So you haven't done anything dishonest. You haven't misled him. He just wants something more.
So what's the problem?
Yeah, what's
just
the problem?
Tell him no.
The problem is dealing with the aftermath. I mean, we have a really good relationship, and from my end, it's a very good friendship.
And, of course, if you had the relationship, you could risk the friendship too, right?
Well, I really don't want to risk the friendship.
I understand that. You don't want the relationship either, but then you just got to assert yourself.
Yeah, and
all.
People understand this. I mean, I have a gay friend who liked me when I met him.
Oh, no, not a gay friend.
Yes.
Oh, we all have gay friends.
Yes, from the theater, coincidentally.
Oh, my God. Not
what a surprise. But, you know, I made it clear to him.
Some
you know.
Of my best friends are homos.
Some of my best friends are straight people.
I was just kidding.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
I made it clear to him that wasn't the way I wanted to go, and I've been friends with a guy for like 6 years now. I mean, they understand, and women understand the same thing, and guys will understand it, and everyone will understand it if you make it clear, but you can't give them mixed messages.
Exactly. Did he put the moves on you before you let him know?
No, he never really put the moves on me. It just...
That's because you're ugly, Adam.
My ass had too much hair on it for his liking.
Is that why you shaved it?
It always comes back to
hey,
this,
Jeffrey,
doesn't it?
Jeffrey, thanks for your call, bro.
Thank you.
Okay. Right now, Holly Hallstrom's our guest.
By the way, we could be talking about Bosnia, and you would work the ass-shaving incident into the conversation, Ricky.
For instance, Bosnia is very cold. Don't shave your ass.
That's right. Your cheek is liable to seize up.
Josh from San Diego, you're on Loveline.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Josh.
Hey, Josh.
What's up?
Hey, well, first I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Yes, sir.
What's the average size for a penis?
Let's ask Holly.
What?
No, poor Holly. Poor Holly's been subjected to enough.
That's true.
There's debate about it, actually. Somebody sent us some data. It was like a little under 6 inches.
No, it's a lot under 6 inches, Drew. Right. It's like five inches under six inches.
Like half an inch under 6 inches.
No, it's like the average penis is about 3 inches, Josh.
Really?
Yeah, so you're pretty stoked, right?
Yeah.
Right on. See, see, I put people in good moods.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, you guys were like talking about the dribbles up the ass last night.
That doesn't sound like us.
There's a lady here, Josh. Yeah, wrong show.
Yeah, you're thinking of Lycus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The one that Mike works on.
My friends, they told me like in Tijuana that there's like chicks that are like do it with donkeys.
All right. Let me tell. I can straighten everyone out on the whole Tijuana scene.
Quiet.
You actually have a tape for this?
What? I have a tape of a woman.
Holly, don't talk. People thought that was you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's a donkey. Donkey was moaning.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Reminded of your last job.
Josh, I am a Tijuana expert. I am the honorary mayor of Tijuana.
Yeah.
Yes. And many years ago, when I was about 16, I went there for the first time, and I'd been there at least 8 or 9 times since every year, although I have not been in a few years. And I can tell you, when I was 16 in Tijuana, there are bars on Revolution Street, underground bars, that a lot of weird stuff goes on stage. Guys doing things to women on stage for a dollar. Crowded public bars. But as far as the donkey show goes, and me and some of my drunken compadres searched long and hard, pardon the pun, for this donkey show. We walked every back street of TJ. We put our head into every door. We asked every store owner and every cab driver.
And they take your money first and tell you there is
no, no. They were up front. They told. They pointed. We walked all it. We never did find one.
There
we
are
could
no
not
donkey
find
shows.
One. So.
And it makes you pretty bummed out when you're 18 thinking that maybe there's a donkey getting some and you still couldn't get
some. Come on, guys. Come on.
What?
Let's
get,
they like make the donkey horny.
Josh, no. Josh, let's get on. We're going to try to help some people here. Thanks so much for
that. That was a help. Josh wanted to know. Yeah. Have you ever seen a donkey show? Is there such thing? Holly?
You're looking at me.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Northern California.
In Northern California?
We didn't have donkey shows there.
Didn't have donkey shows in Northern California?
This is the closest I have ever come to a donkey show is right here tonight.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. That's what most guests on LoveLine have said. Right now, we're going to talk to Doug from Encino. Doug, you're on with Holly Hallstrom.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I have a little problem with my girlfriend, which maybe you guys can help me with. She left for college in September. Mm. And
where is she now?
She's
how
up
far away?
Santa Cruz.
Uh-huh.
And she so what happened was, you know, since her funds are a little tight, since she's up there, she wanted me to call her every day. And
her what?
She wanted me to call her every day.
Her what?
Her buns are
funds.
Tight.
That's what I thought
funds.
He said.
Funds.
Funds. Oh, funds.
She can't call him.
Well, her buns are really tight. And I'm like, I don't need to know.
Your mind is so twisted, Ricky. I knew she
you
said
were the
funds.
One that said it first.
I knew she said funds. I was making fun of her funds.
Hmm.
Okay, so in any event, so she wanted me to call her every day. And after a while, I was thinking, I really don't, you know, and what is there to talk about every day? And so I said that, you know, I thought that it wasn't necessary just a few days ago. And she got completely enraged with she got really mad. She hung up the phone, and she so she's giving me a sort of like an ultimatum. You know, you call me every day, you know, or else we're not going to. You know, and I really don't want.
What should he do, Holly?
How long have you been dating?
Since it's going to be a year at the end of January.
All right, Holly, come on. Woman's perspective on this.
Yeah.
Well, it depends. What do you want out of the relationship? Do you want to continue this relationship, or do you want to blow it off?
I sort of want to, but then again, I'm young, you know, and I've got, and I got a lot
sex.
Ahead of me. So, I mean, I'm not sure because, I mean, I don't want to have to, like, I'm keep in contact with her every day or else she'll get mad at me. I mean, that's just not necessary.
Well, did you make it very clear? Did you explain to her why you...
Yes, I mean, I just thought that, you know, I don't know, because she was making it like I have to check in every day. You know, if I don't talk, like, for this certain amount of time, she'll be upset that I don't talk to her enough, you know.
Doug!
Sounds like she's insecure in the relationship.
Yeah. Doug, let me give Holly a quick hypothetical here. Let's just say we're going out. Let's say, you know.
You and Doug are going out, Adam, okay?
No, Adam and Holly, which is like a stretch.
Me and Bob Barker. Shut up, Drew. Just go along. Let's just say,
Adam and Holly are going out.
Yeah. Let me just paint it. Close your eyes for a second, Holly.
Okay.
Let me just paint a little scenario.
Okay.
The show goes good. The show goes real good tonight.
Mm-hmm.
You end up staying till 12.
Mm-hmm.
You got no job. You don't have to get up in the morning. This is my only crappy job. I'm not going anywhere in the morning. So we decide to go out for a nightcap.
Okay.
We end up going back to your pad so I can look at the action on your trash can.
Yes. One thing leads to another, and it's the best night of your life.
Really?
She's shaving your ass.
Oh, God damn it, Ricky. Now, no promises, but some dialogue, you know, the next morning, and I'm off to the shooting range and then off to help the mentally handicapped. Would you expect a call every day, or could we just sort of keep it to a weekend thing?
Well, I tell you, I would be expecting you to call every hour on the hour and gifts arriving frequently.
Pee on this stick for me. Stop that. Stop it. Ricky, you're just out of control tonight. God, I feel like my three-year-old kids. Honest to God.
Whip them. Whip them.
Whip me, please.
Here, you
please.
Can borrow my boots.
Oh, yeah. I like those boots. Bob Barker is an idiot. I got to just tell you that. Bob Barker is a friggin' moron, man. Let's go to Tracy from San Diego.
Wait, I don't think. Did we get a read?
Who cares?
I'm calling every hour.
All right. You're set.
Oh, okay. What are we going to say to that guy? Okay, I'll say my advice to that guy. Get some balls, wimp boy.
Here, I think he needs
to. No, he needs to.
He needs to end that relationship, I think. I think what her problem is that she is so fearful of losing it and going through the process of the loss that the threat of loss leads her to want to just like get it over with.
Are you talking about me and Holly now?
No, you go back to the trash can, actually.
No.
Hello.
Tracy, hi. How you doing?
Hello.
I have kind of an embarrassing question to ask.
Oh.
This is just the place to ask it.
I know. Okay. My husband has got this thing going where I think he has a problem with passing gas.
Ricky, honest to God, I wish I had a stick tonight. Just smack him every time.
She says passing gas. I have to do
Did you
the
have
color
to do
commentary.
It?
What? I'm here for color commentary tonight, okay?
Now, it happens during...
Why is everybody... I look over to Ann for like, that was a good one, Ricky. And Ann is like, Ricky, stop it.
Stop it.
Mike enjoys it.
I'm going to go say, thanks.
Tracy.
Don't say his name.
Yeah. Oh, sorry,
He's
Mike.
He's so proud of the show, nobody wants to know that his name is Mike.
Tracy.
Yes?
Is this only during sex?
No. It's during sex, but it's like all the time.
All the time.
Yeah, like when we're eating.
We were talking about this last night. If you start giggling when he breaks wind, he's going to look at that as a big thumbs up.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is. Let me ask you something, Ricky. You fart in front of your wife. She yells, "That is disgusting. That is foul. Don't you ever do that in front of me again." You don't fart in front of her next time, right?
Right.
You fart in front of her and she starts giggling along. You're trying to work up another one. Your arm's cocked. You got a vein bulging in your forehead.
No.
Am I right?
No.
Holly, did this man of 6 years ever fart in front of you? I'll punch him if he did.
No, he didn't.
Oh, come on. Seriously. No. Even during the heat of passion?
No, I can guarantee you.
Oh, that was the problem.
That was the one I couldn't talk
about. There wasn't very much passion in that relationship, was there?
Why do you think I'm so... disappointed Pendant. It's over.
Oh, there was good passion. No,
yeah. Why do you think we stayed together six
Did you
years?
Wear the boots?
No, he liked to wear the boots.
Tracy, just hold on with the gas for 1 second. I guess.
Yeah, because we're going somewhere
Holly,
else. Much
question.
More fun.
Holly, you admitted that you're 43,
mm-hmm.
and you don't look a day over 30, but I always have this theory about a woman's sexual appetite sort of increasing as she gets a little
it's
older.
It's true.
Because when you were 23... It was just once a day, right?
Yeah.
Now that you're,
yeah.
Yeah, but you're more at 43 than you were at 23. Am I right?
Yep.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's usually
true,
God's
Adam.
Cruel joke, but in your case, it's good.
Oh, Adam, it's so good.
Oh man! Now Drew wants us to go back to Tracy and her problem with her husband farting.
Well, this sounds very simple to me. It sounds like he needs a good nutritionist.
Really?
That's what I think, too.
Mm-hmm.
It's nerve gas,
or
Tracy.
Good dump.
When a man
Bino.
Thinks he's going to get sex, the stomach, the acid starts churning. Am I right, Drew? There is a phenomenon. Get up in your seat and tell us about this.
Nerve gas?
Yes. There is a phenomenon. What's it called?
Irritable bowel.
Right. Spastic you think colon. You're getting some. All of a sudden, the adrenaline's pumping, stuff's churning, acid's building up.
That is a stress-induced
Right, there can be that. But I agree with you. I think a lot of it is dependent on what's delivered to that part of the colon. And
ask the questions, Drew. Did his parents have gas?
No. Kind of
were they gasaholics? I'm serious. I felt something coming on just from Holly's little sex talk just the last second.
That was
second
a boner,
there.
Adam.
Oh, is that what that was? Yeah. Oh, it's in front. That's right.
We're going to play some commercials.
Love, you go ahead. LoveLine, it will be right. LoveLine. Sorry,
but we don't have that kind of time. LoveLine will be right back.
Hey, we said that.
Yeah, you did.
Welcome back to LoveLine. Holly Hallstrom, formerly The Price is Right, is our guest. And you know what else, Adam?
Huh.
Obviously gorgeous.
Right.
Good personality.
Right.
She rides motorcycles.
Really?
Really.
Man, why you aren't, like, taken. Now,
it's not like she couldn't have anybody she wanted.
In this room. Let's go to some calls right now. Let's talk to Dave from Chicago. Dave, you're on LoveLine.
Yeah, like I said, I'm Dave. Hi, guys. How you doing?
Dave.
Hi.
I'm, like, having, like, serious problems with relationships in the past, like, 5 years. Recently, today, I caught my girlfriend of 3 years in bed with another guy.
Break up with her.
Now, did you really catch her in bed? I mean, you hear that term thrown around, but well, did you walk in and she was actually in bed getting it on?
They were asleep. I guess they were, like, through or whatever.
Right. What'd you
well,
do?
You know, he came on. He was tired, you know, and, he just kind of laid down to rest.
Well,
and
I'm feeling kind of great because I, like, beat the crap out of him.
Oh.
Like a couple of shots to the head.
With like, your fist?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't want to kill him or anything.
Did you know the guy?
No. I'd never seen him before.
So, all right, this isn't a bogus call, Dave?
Oh, no.
Dave, what is your question exactly?
Well, my question is, this is like the third time this has happened to me.
That somebody has gone out on you?
This is the third girlfriend that I've caught, actually caught.
All right.
At this point.
And what do they tell you?
They just call and say that they want to break up or they need some space, and in fact, they're actually already sleeping with someone else.
Is there any common thread to how you conduct yourself in relationships?
That's what I'm asking. I'm
you know what? I almost don't want to even get into it too much because we're not going to be able to figure this out
on
radio.
Well, not only is it how he's conducting himself in the relationship, but it's who he's choosing to have a relationship with.
But it's real simple. The solution is very simple.
And look at the way the hand goes up. It's like
She does that like over here.
Over here
is
the zebra.
Over here is the solution. Dave needs to get himself into therapy, and because this is obviously a pattern. And discover where the pattern came from, break it, start a new pattern, and move on.
That's sort of what I was saying, too. I mean, this is something more complex than we could probably get into the radio. I mean, he may be abusing his women some way. He may be getting abused in some way. Who knows what's going on here?
And don't punch the guy in the head, because this poor guy's just some sap she works with who doesn't know any better.
Well, I got him when he was still asleep, so he didn't know.
Now that's macho.
Chivalry is not dead. Marcus of Queensberry rules. Hit the guy while he's passed out.
Yeah, I'll kick Mike Tyson's ass if he was sleeping. And I had a good 50-yard dash.
One shot before the sodomy begins, Ricky.
Yeah. I definitely recommend therapy because the next one might wake up after the first punch and just beat the tar out of you.
All right. Right now, let's go to Brandy from Vandenberg Air Force Base. You live on the Air Force Base?
Yes, I do.
All right. Are you one of those Air Force brats?
I am Air Force.
Oh, you are
you're
Air Force.
In the Air Force?
Yes, I am.
Oh, I'm sorry. Shinsei, come kick my ass.
She's got boots, too.
Women's Army Corps are WAX, right? Now, what's the women's air? Are those WAX, too?
WAFs. WAFs.
WAFs? WAFs?
WAFs.
Women's Air Force? Are you WAFs?
Sure. No, I'm a cop in the Air Force.
You're a cop?
Uh-huh.
You've got a great voice.
Thank you.
Big boots.
Just trying to be nice.
Oh, she's an MP.
She will kick our ass. Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, well, I had a question for Dr. Dre.
Yeah, Drew.
Dr. Dre?
Dr. Drew, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Brandy, what's up?
You know, Dr. Dre is in the house.
Brandy.
Okay, well, my question is, I have two. The first one is that if I use a condom, whenever right. okay, whenever I have sex and I use a condom, mm-hmm. I always get an infection the next day. And I'm wondering if, I mean, I've tried all different kinds, mm-hmm. the lubricated, the not lubricated, and everything. And I was wondering if I'm allergic to it, and if I am, if there's anything else that I could use other okay. than a condom for disease purposes.
All right. What kind of infection do you think you get?
Like, it's a yeast infection. So,
and you treat it as yeast infection, it goes away?
Mm-hmm.
I can't promise you that that's an allergy, but it could be an allergic reaction. It could mm-hmm. be sort of setting up the environment for a yeast infection to occur. And it turns out that latex allergy is much more common than we used to think. So it is certainly a possibility. You might want to try the polyurethane condom. And if I read the package right yesterday on the female condom, that's polyurethane.
The Love Bucket?
Yeah, whatever that was.
What about one of those sheepskin ones?
Or animal skin. But again, she's worried about – are you worried just about
would
contraception?
Would you use one of those since you're a vegetarian?
You know, this whole era, avenue of condoms is new to me. I've been in a relationship for 6 years. I don't know anything about condoms.
You would use a sheepskin condom, just wouldn't eat
what
it.
What is a sheepskin condom?
Well, it's a sheep gut or something.
It's like
what is
tripe
it?
Or something?
Basically.
Oh, gosh.
And it is not a good barrier against the viral sexually transmitted diseases, so you should stay with
it. It isn't.
What
about a Crown Royal sack? Is that?
What? Oh, gosh.
Gutty Sark.
With a Coke chaser.
Hey, Brandy, polyurethane.
Can an Air Force cop write off a fix-it ticket?
A wet ticket?
Never mind.
Ricky got a little busted.
I got a babe. That cop pulled me over and he goes, oh, I got a long one for you.
He got a fix-it ticket for his hair.
And I did. And right now we're going to talk to, let's talk to Karen from Colorado. Karen.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Holly.
Hi, Karen.
When's someone going to tell Bob Barker he's getting old and ugly, huh?
We talked about that.
Oh, that's funny.
Well, I'm a little embarrassed about what I'm calling about, but I've been in a relationship with a man for 5 years, and we have a great relationship. We get along wonderfully. We're best friends. But the last couple of years, our sex life has totally waned, and we've lost all passion, and we still get along great, and we still want to be together. We're having a great time. He's still interested in sex, and I've totally lost it. And I've asked my girlfriends about it, but I would like to know what some guys have, some advice for me or what I can do to get him more interesting or something.
So he's not doing it. He's still interested, but he's not doing it for you.
Yeah, I'm his first main sex partner he's ever really had. And obviously I didn't teach him well enough in the first few years.
You mean teach him?
Well, you know.
Well, that's actually true. Women do teach the guys. I'm telling you straight out.
Oh, he was?
Yeah.
But he's still into it?
Yeah.
And you're the one who's bored?
Well, yeah.
Okay. All right. So
no,
you need some.
No
you, all right. You need some tips. Well, we happen to have a older, but none the worse for wear, experienced spokesmodel here who's going to clue this guy in. Well, she'll tell you, and then you can tell him.
Okay.
Holly.
Well, actually, is it you're just losing interest with him, or is it just with sex in general?
No. Definitely not with him. He's pretty much the best I've found. He's great as a best friend, but it's turned into kind of a brotherly, sisterly feeling I have for him. But
that sort of says it all right there, doesn't it? I mean, your feelings have changed.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's hard to have passionate sex when you're picturing your brother on top of you.
If you ask a bunch of guys what they think, they're going to start thinking about the mechanics and, you know, the
right.
velocities.
Like, I got
things.
A schematic and, I want you to
right,
look at.
And Holly immediately says, how have your feelings changed?
Yeah. Well,
and that's the much more important thing for women.
And I
all right, but Drew, which are you, a guy or a girl?
I'm just...
All right, then keep your trap shut.
He's neither. He's a doctor, damn it.
I'm just interpreting what is.
I think if he just learned how to slow down or to kind of learn how to have a little more finesse, things could be a lot different.
Karen. Well, you know, Karen, you have to ask yourself, do you want the relationship to endure, or are you ready emotionally to move on? And if you want it to continue, then why not take some classes mm-hmm. with a, you know, there are classes, maybe tantra yoga, sex instruction.
Really? Oh, hold on.
And, you know, there are definitely classes for learning, or doctors, for learning how to put the spice back into your
now,
sex.
Do they have that down at the Y, or do you have to go somewhere special?
I think that is the, is that the Young Women's Christian Association?
Yes.
I don't think they have it at that.
Weird sex classes forming next month. It's out on the billboard. Well, all right. But here's my take on all this stuff. And I hate to say this, but
then don't.
I'm just gonna. When it's gone, it's gone. Yeah. I mean, like, you're looking at this guy as your brother,
it's
and
gone.
Your brother puts on, like, a leather jock strap, that doesn't turn you on. And, Ricky, if your sister put on a nightie...
Oh, shut up. I'm going to throw up. I mean, I love my
but
sister,
I like
but
it.
Don't make me
but
throw
the point,
up.
But the point is it doesn't matter. It's your sister in a nightie, or it's your sister beating you with a riding crop, or it's your sister playing the Tupperware woman and coming to the
but
door.
Who told you?
That I could let... I mean, sex is not that big of a deal to me, so...
Well, not anymore.
Years, even without it, has been great.
Well, you can stretch out the relationship long as you like, but it sounds
guys,
it's going a direction.
Is that what you want in your life, Karen? Will you be happy with a relationship
Karen
that
wants,
has no passion?
Karen wants a woman.
No. Yes.
Karen is a clam smacker. Oh, yes, you are. And that's okay, Karen.
How are you picking up on that?
I'm picking up on it, too.
Oh, yeah. I'm saying
what?
She is.
What?
Yeah. Karen wants girls.
That's not
Karen,
it.
Karen, try being with a woman.
No.
Yeah, try it.
Well, no,
but I do think you are fairly. You
have
are,
you, Ricky? Have you ever been with a woman?
No. What's it like? Is that a proposition?
Maybe what these guys are picking up on is that you seem pretty detached from and pretty
no,
much
I
denying
actually, well,
your feelings. You just don't, you don't want to accept them.
We had a break in our relationship last year, and I ended up sleeping with one of his friends.
Oops.
I'll see your whore.
That's healthy.
Thanks for your call,
Karen. Well, no,
I don't want to talk to her anymore.
Oh, come on.
No. She's up with her boyfriend's friend. We got to go to commercials. I want to thank Holly for coming down here because we told you an hour ago we were going to let you go, and we didn't. And, hey, feel free to come back anytime there's a lawsuit or anytime something else going on or anything.
Anytime.
Oh, they turned her mic off already. See how Mike did? Is your mic on?
Hello.
Bastard.
Yes. Yeah.
And if you're, like, selling anything or
in Southern
boots,
California, wherever, just come on by.
Or you guys need some more advice on your hair and things like
exactly.
that. I'd be happy to come down.
Holly Hallstrom's been our guest on LoveLine. Stay tuned because we got a little bit more.
Hello.
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 LoveLine will be right back.
Back on LoveLine. I gotta just tell our producer Ann, where'd you go, Ann? Ann has been just ruling two nights in a row. Not tough women to look at, I'm telling you. Holly Hallstrom is just smoking, man. She looks so awesome.
She is.
Last night, Heather Tom, who I thought was just hot. I thought she was hot. You guys didn't think it was all that much.
We weren't on board with you completely. As we weren't in the front of the bus. We were like in the middle on the Heather Tom bus. But
she was
hot.
She was hot.
Oh, believe me, I would never, ever dream of turning that
just
down.
Just that kind of hot, blonde, blue-eyed, white trash look. I'm so into that.
And, but you know...
She was hot.
And
but you know what the best... You know what the best part about it was? The best part about what I was telling Ann is, the best part about being married is because I sit there and I go, if I was single, I'd be getting these chicks. Knowing that, of course, I never would get them. I couldn't stand a chance. But I'm married now, so I go, oh, I could have had Holly.
Let me tell you the best part about being single. I can go home and masturbate without any interruption. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I do, Adam. Yes, I'm reading your mail, my friend.
I think I could add Holly, seriously.
Huh?
I think I could add Holly.
Dude, I don't know why you didn't. She is hot. How tall is she?
She's like 9 feet tall.
Oh, she's a bitch. And I got to say this real quick about The Price is Right, okay? Women that watch that show, okay, who would they rather see? These 20-year-old, you know, bims, or these 43-year-old girls that just look awesome? I mean, what a moron to get rid of her. She is just killer.
Yeah. Good sense of humor.
I'd watch that frigging game show now.
She's got a robotic trash can at her place. I mean,
she
is really
some
together.
Some yoga.
Yeah,
stuff.
When we got into the sex thing, she immediately went Tatanka. like a Kevin Costner movie,
like,
you know?
What is Tatanka?
I have no idea, but she knew immediately this weird yoga stuff. Lord knows what she's into. I bet she's got like rattan chairs swinging on chains and stuff with holes in them. And
yeah.
She's in all kinds of stuff. See,
I think her, the guy that was with her, I think the guy that was with her for his first 6 years or something just broke up because she put him in traction.
Yeah, he died.
All right, guys,
yeah.
he died.
He died a sexual death.
You guys done just gushing, right?
All right. Wow, and who's our guest tomorrow, Ann?
Cute guys.
Who?
The Goo Goo Dolls.
Oh, Goo Goo Dolls. Yeah, yeah. Ann got back at me. You know who she's got as a guest coming next week?
Candlebox.
Dave Navarro. Look at the, listen to the dick.
Red Hot
Watch this. Watch. Dave Navarro.
Your wife's happy, Ricky.
She got him trained like SEALs.
I call Ricky today and let him know, and his wife starts screaming.
Oh, shut up. You know, like, you know what they do on my birthday? My birthday, it's like, hey, Ricky, it's your birthday. We're going to have Bush on. So here comes my wife bringing me a big old birthday cake for my birthday. Oh, and I didn't even know that Gavin would be here. What a crock. Oh, Lord. I guarantee if it would have been Lemmy that I wouldn't have had no birthday cake that night. Maybe. I don't know. Let's go to Tim from Minneapolis. Tim, you're on LoveLine.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, guys.
Hey. Good.
I have a question about, well, me and my girlfriend have been together for almost a year now, and sex is pretty good, but I just want to give something back to her, and I just want to, like, help her have a better orgasm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How can I do that?
We're going to send Adam over right now.
I'll tell you, do we want to go around on this one? Who wants to start? You want me to start?
Do you perform oral sex on her?
Yes.
Do you know what you're doing?
I think so.
Yeah, I'm just asking. I don't.
Use your mouth, though, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Take your glasses off first.
Glasses.
Okay.
Shave.
Do we want to go around on this one? We don't. Drew doesn't want. Ricky, well, all right, I'll go first. Let me tell you, Tim, I've talked about this before. Women are into, guys are
shoes.
Into the physical stuff. Women are into shoes. But guys are into, women are into all the different senses. You know what I mean? So first you got to set a little mood. I mean, don't concentrate on the crotch so much. Concentrate on the environment a little. Light a little incense. Light a candle, put on a little Barry White or maybe a little classical, whatever music she's into, some sex music, right?
Yeah.
Give her a glass of red wine. You know what I mean? Get all the intangibles set up. Then get down there and don't try to work harder, work softer. Do you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to give her a bigger orgasm, but that doesn't mean come on stronger.
Right.
Means back off a little bit, you know? Do a little teasing. Change it up. You got to be like a good pitcher on the mound. You don't just keep coming with the fastball. You got to work in the slider, the changeup, and the split finger. Occasionally the spitball. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know exactly.
I say when you're going down there, in one hand, grab $50, and right when you're going down there, put it in her hand and say, you can go buy some shoes when we're done. Yeah,
dude,
she'll lose it.
Try to work shoes in it.
Chicks dig shoes.
And I'm gonna say this, and I know because it's late. Tim?
Yeah.
You got a vibrator?
No.
Get one of those vibrators.
You have a vibrator?
Yeah, I got one. Yeah.
What would I do?
Well, you know, I don't use it on myself. But listen, Tim, the ladies are sitting up in their seats over there. Tim, let me tell you something.
Yeah.
Don't go get one. Now, come on. You're ruining the mood. Don't get, like, one that's shaped like a mallet or anything. Get just a $5 cheapo one.
Oh, get the hummingbird.
Yeah, well, you don't get the one that's shaped like
the
penis.
The pachyderm.
Relax over here. I'm getting serious with this guy. I'm trying to help him. Tim.
That sounds like those Cox .049 motors.
Burning alcohol. Get one. They work. A couple of C batteries.
Yeah.
Now, listen, just get the cheapo one. Okay, get down there and work the vibrator in conjunction with the mouth. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Put the thing on your cheek a little bit and get your whole mouth going.
And he doesn't know what he's talking about.
Am I right, Ann?
Well, first of all.
Yes, the woman.
You get the one that looks like a big bullet.
Right, right. That's what I'm saying. Not like a penis, not like a big deluxe one. $6.
$6?
Yeah. Go into any store. It's
any
just,
store.
Well, not in Utah. But, I mean, go to any sex place and just buy the cheapest one you can find. Just a streamlined, smooth plastic.
Smooth.
Not black. No big eliminator. Red letters written up down the side. No, like, Apollo 13 or anything on it. No, like, Widowmaker, Gypsy Queen or anything like that.
If there wasn't anything else, or if there is anything else, what would you suggest?
You don't want to go? Let me tell you something.
I'm not so comfortable.
All right, Tim, let me tell you about the vibrator,
Wait, Tim, you having orgasms?
Yeah.
Who cares, then?
Ricky, I'm trying to help Tim.
Come on.
Ann's going to back me up on this one,
right,
too. Here's what you do with the vibrator.
You're
may
so
get
full
a,
of crap, Adam.
I'm totally serious here.
That's like me giving expert advice how to play baseball.
Look, some the people who do, and those who don't teach.
Do. I want to talk to the woman.
What?
I want to talk with Ann.
Are you afraid to bring a vibrator into it?
He's jerking off right now, Ann.
Yeah. No, I'm not afraid to bring it into it. I just don't know if I want to go there.
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
Well, she has a phobia of them.
All right, let me tell you how to deal
what kind
with
of
that.
Phobia?
I'm going to straighten him
out. She was once swimming and got hit by a submarine.
Tim?
Yeah.
Here's what you do. You don't yank out the vibrator when you guys are in the hall of the apartment building and wave it around the mailbox. You slip it under the pillow.
Right.
Then you get things going. And you get the light, you dim the lights, you get things going, and you sneak it in the back door. Am I right, Ann?
The back door?
Well, no, not, I mean,
not the
you,
back
you
door.
Make it around the back, though. You know, I'm not saying
right.
up there, but I'm saying you slide the thing out, and it'll be like a second of, it'll be, here's what the reaction will be, Tim. Huh? Oh.
Exactly.
Am I right, Ann?
Exactly. Get her really hot and say, hey, why don't we try this?
Right.
And she will
right.
just, she'll be very excited.
Okay.
That's right.
Thanks for your call,
all
Tim.
Right.
Wait a minute. Are you trying to go to commercials?
No, I'm going
to
go jerk off.
Can I say something here? A guy named Matt faxed me something. If I could bring us back down to this planet.
Yeah, the stuff that's really interesting that people really want
marijuana
to talk.
He sent me a marijuana chapter, and it says in one of the things he underlined wanted me to comment on tonight, and I promised him I would, was that marijuana becomes embedded in cell membranes, causing them to become clogged, blocking glucose input, and the cells die. There is evidence that there is brain cell death from marijuana and hallucinogen exposure. That is one of the possible mechanisms whereby that could occur. Makes sense to me. I think there might be some other mechanisms as well.
Huh?
Loveline will be right back when we're damn good and ready.
Hey, tomorrow on Loveline, the Doo Doo Gals. Oh, Goo Goo Dolls. I'm sorry, I read that wrong. Goo Goo Dolls. Actually, they were on Loveline about 6 months ago. Very cool. And you know what? Even though I'm not like into a lot of mellow songs, I still like that song. I'm not sick of that song yet. Name. Even though I'm sure some people have heard it so many times they're sick of it, I still kind of like that song. I don't know why.
Well, it's a good song.
Makes me sad.
It's kind of like a Runaway Train. Strumming guitar. You know what I'm talking about?
Guitar, isn't it? Yeah.
Well, that same would be type the of song, if you had to classify it.
Don't be a pain in the ass. Sarah!
Hey, guys.
Hey, girl. What city are you calling from?
Minneapolis.
Oh.
I first have to say, Dr. Drew, if you weren't on this show, I would probably have to turn it off. You are the most normal person on that crew, but I like the other guys, too. You guys are funny.
Thank you.
Thank you.
But I'm normal, don't do drugs, any of that stuff, and I still catch your show. Very, very good show. But
if anything, I want to be dominated. What is that?
I would like to say about Tim, who was calling in, about how to make it a little bit more fun for her. It's how about starting like the feet? Give her a foot massage, work up to the knee. Adam, why do you answer these questions? And you're the only one out there that doesn't have a girl.
He's the only one having sex.
That's right.
Oh, okay. But, yeah, just do things that you normally don't do and think of it as a girl as a crock pot and a man's a microwave. It takes a woman a lot longer to warm up than it does a man.
Hold on.
And it smells like stew?
Hey.
Start with the feet and think of her as a crock pot.
Well, yeah, we have to warm up slow. We can't just, we got 3 minutes to spare, let's hop in the sack.
So, Sarah, you're saying a massage is in order. That would be a good thing.
Really, yeah. It's just light. Things that other than the sexual part.
You know what's interesting about guys and massages I learned from personal experience?
What's that?
You
give guys massage?
No, I give gals massage, Sarah.
Okay.
Although you may fall into some kind of gray area, I'm not sure. But but listen, Sarah, I'd probably give you one, too.
If he was drunk.
The deal is...
And alone.
Is guys are dying to give girls a massage before they see them naked. Because when a guy says, can I give you a massage, a guy's saying, can I see you nude?
Big high five on that one, Adam. Work that one.
Because you guys are just dying to give girls a massage before they see them. Because if a guy, after a guy's seen a woman nude for like 6 months, the whole massage subject out the window. He'll never bring it up again.
Guys are going to kill you, Adam. This is one of those secrets, the guy secrets that guys keep to guys.
Oh, it is.
I'm going to give you a massage means I'm going to see you naked or try.
Because it's perfect. Because if a guy's smart, he won't say take the shirt off. He'll do it. And he'll like catch his thumb on the bra like a few times and be real clumsy and go, I'm really having trouble working around this.
A woman likes that too, though. It's a little bit, not the game playing, but a little fun.
I'm just saying, once the guy can see her naked in other situations, the massages stop.
Yeah. He's already had
it. It's an excuse to see a woman nude.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's all right. But it's a nice way for a woman, though. That for me, anyway, gets a little more exciting.
So start with the feet.
Sure.
And move your
knees and...
Now, do you stop at the groin, or do you just keep going?
No, just go around the sides of her body. Don't go for the sexual parts, the parts that you want to see.
Right.
Start with the clothes on. There's nothing wrong with that.
All right. Sarah, it's something about your dialect. It's like your mom. It's like your mom talking dirty to you or something.
Hey, I have two kids. I listen to the show and think, oh, God, if they come home with piercings like that and red hair. Like
God
this.
Love those children, Sarah.
I know you do. That's why God hasn't let you breed yet.
Wow.
Love your show up here, guys. You keep me awake at night.
All right. Thanks, Sarah.
Nice to always end the show on someone putting me down. So let's talk to Chris for 2 seconds. Chris, you're on LoveLine.
Yeah, Adam.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to tell you, I shave my ass, too.
Okay, thanks for sharing. Well, that's it for tonight's show. If you want to email LoveLine, please do at LUV191 on America Online. And if you want to write me, I'm starting a mailing list because I'm going to be putting out a big newsletter, just bringing people up to date with things, RIKIR on AOL. Perhaps you would like to do one better and write us a letter like real American people do. P.O. Box 4345, Hollywood, California, 90078 is the number again. That's P.O. Box 4345, Hollywood, California, 90078. What are you doing?
What the hell is that, Mike?
Yeah, stop it, Mike, or we'll say your last name. Tom Likas gets to say his last name. Hey, Goo Goo Dolls are going to be on LoveLine tomorrow night.
And they're a good band, not just the name song,
but they rock
pretty good because I saw them at Acoustic Christmas and they were good.
They're a goo band.
Goo you.
Yeah, singer gets chicks.
No kidding.
And so we want to thank Sherry and Lori for doing a wonderful job on the phones this evening.
Yes.
It was a splendid night. Want to thank Mike for whatever he does. We want to thank Producer Ann for also getting two hot chicks two nights in a row. And what was that?
Just a little semi-4 vibrator motion for Ann over there.
You guys doing a little sex thing. And
Ann's warming up to the man. I think she's
the ass. On behalf of myself, Ricky Rackman.
Dr. Drew.
And Adam Carolla.
Thanks for being a part of tonight's LoveLine.
Have been listening to LoveLine. The opinions expressed by Ricky Rackman, Dr. Drew, Adam Carolla, or anybody else on this program are not necessarily anyone's. LoveLine producer Ann Wilkins.